Hello everybody, welcome back to another video lesson. This is the e-learning space for MGM Higher Secondary School, Bokaro. And this is your first video for lesson number 5 of Grammar, English Class 8. Lesson number 5 of Grammar is titled Verbs. It is one of the parts of the speech that we are going to deal today. Let us begin with the very basic, the definition of verb. From the very beginning, from the primary level itself, we have heard that verb is a doing word. Verb is an action word. So a verb is a word that tells what someone or something does. An action word or word of being, a state of being as well. For example, sit, laugh, run, jump. These words show some kind of action and these are verbs. Now verbs can be of two different types, regular or irregular. Let us understand what are regular. Regular verbs are those verbs that form their past participle with adding d or ed. These verbs do not undergo substantial changes while changing forms between tenses. As we know, there are past tense, present tense and future tense, and the verb undergoes changes according to the change in the tense. However, there is no substantial change in regular verbs. For example, if the base form is accept, simple past becomes accepted with the simple addition of ed, and past participle is also accepted with the simple addition of ed. Similarly, for the other examples given here, achieve becomes achieved, add becomes added, admire becomes admired. I have given you a table of around 50 regular verbs. When we are studying verbs, it is very important to know the different forms of the verbs. This is also going to help us when we deal with our chapter on tenses. So please write these in your copies and learn them. Coming to irregular verbs. Irregular verbs are those verbs that undergo substantial changes when changing forms between tenses. For example, be is the base form. And in simple past, it is was in singular and were in plural. In past participle, it becomes been. The changed forms of these verbs are often unrecognizably different from the originals. Means the word completely changed from the original base form. Once again, children, I have given you some 50 common irregular verbs. What is the base form, what is the past simple form, and what is the participle form? Please write it in your copies and learn it. Now, coming to finite verbs. What are finite verbs? As the title itself suggests, finite means limited. And what are they limited by? By number or the person of its subject. And also on the tense of the subject. So those verbs which depend on its subject to take their forms are called finite verbs. For example, look at the sentence here. They play football. Over here the subject they is plural and the verb remains play. But when the subject changes he, which is singular, the verb changes its form. It becomes singular verb, plays. You are playing football. Depending on the subject you, it is becoming present continuous. But when we change the subject to she and the tenses change, suppose it is past continuous tense, it becomes she was playing football. So those verbs which change their form depending on the subject, the number, the tense, they are called finite verbs. So, of course, there will be non-finite verbs as well, and these are just the opposite of finite verbs. Non-finite verbs, they do not change their form, even when the person or the number of the subject changes, or the tense of the sentence changes. Let us see the example. They want to eat something delicious. They is plural. She wants to eat something delicious. She is singular. However, in both the cases, the verb to eat remains the same. Similarly, he wants to play football. They want to play football. They want to eat eggs for breakfast. They here is plural. He is singular, but the verb remains in the same form, to play. These kinds of verbs that do not have any effect because of the subject or the number or the tense of the sentence are called non-finite verbs. Now, based on this knowledge, we can divide verbs into two parts, the finite verbs and the non-finite verbs. And once again, the non-finite verbs are divided into three different kinds. What are they? Participle, gerund, and infinitives. We shall deal with each of these topics in detail in this video lesson. Beginning with infinitives. Infinitives are defined as to plus the base form of the verb. They have several functions. Let us see what are the functions. Used as subjects and subject complement. To know me is to love me. Whenever the base form of the verb is attached with the to, when a to is added with the base form, it becomes infinitive and it becomes the subject of the sentence or the subject complement. Means it completes the subject. To live in Hawaii is my lifetime dream. So here the verb to live is an infinitive. It is a part of the non-finite verb. Second usage of infinitives is used as objects following certain verbs. I want to tell you how much I appreciated your gift. Means there are certain verbs that always take to before it. I want to ask. I want to go. He wants to stay. These are certain verbs that will always be preceded by a to, and these are infinitives. They become the object of a certain verb. Come to gerund. A gerund is the ing form of a verb used as a noun and used in the same ways as a noun. It is actually a verb which, because ing has been added to it, becomes a noun. And you know, noun is the name of something. So how is gerund used? First of all, it is used as a subject. Swimming is a good sport. Over here, swimming is a name of a sport. It is not the activity, it is the name of the sport. And the base word swim is actually a verb. So this is a gerund. Similarly, jogging keeps our body healthy. Singing makes us happy. Gerund as object. Gerald loves traveling. What does Gerald love? What is the object here? Traveling. Loves is the verb. And traveling, travel is actually the base form is a verb. But while adding ing to it, it becomes a gerund. It acts as a object. It becomes a noun. Albert likes reading short stories. Gerund as object preposition. For example, they like by hunting. She has gone before saying anything. These are the object prepositions. So gerund works as subject, as object, and as object prepositions. Let us understand what is a gerund by a little comparison. As we know, a gerund is the ing form of a verb used as a subject or object in a sentence, and it becomes a noun in the sentence. For example, look at these sentences. Running is my favorite form of exercise. Over here, running acts as a noun. It is a type of exercise. We like running. I'm not saying we like to run. In that case, it is not a gerund and it is a verb. We like running. Again, running here is a noun. But if we say we are running, then we are doing some activity. This running becomes an activity. It is not a noun. Hence, it is not a gerund. Once you practice some worksheets, these will become clearer. Let us come to participle. What is a participle? A verbal that functions as an adjective. There are two types of participles, past and present. Present participle ends in ing, but past participles usually end with ed or en. Example, the flying fish. It is present participle, flying. The broken window, broken, en. It's a past participle. It acts as an adjective sometimes. The broken window, describing the window. The flying fish, describing the fish. What are phrasal verbs? A phrasal verb is a verb plus a preposition or adverb which creates a meaning different from the original verb. Let us see an example. I ran into my teacher at the movies last night. Ran into doesn't really mean that you bumped into someone. It simply means when we take the base form of the verb run and then we add into, it becomes ran into, and this means meet. So it is a verb, it is turned into a phrase, and the meaning is a little different from the original verb. He ran away when he was 15. It only means he left home. So the meaning is a little different from the original base form of the verb. This is a phrasal verb. Let us practice a little bit more about phrasal verbs. See, here is a word hang. It is the base verb. If we use it with onto, hang onto, it becomes, the meaning changes to continue something, making an effort to do this. Example, I will hang on to the documents for a bit longer. If we use hang with another word back, hang back, it means to be reluctant to carry on. There's no need to hang back, we can sing as well as anyone. Hang around, to move or to do something slowly. Don't hang around, you have a train to catch. So the word hang has a completely different meaning, but we add certain other words to it and the meaning changes slightly. These are called phrasal verb. Hang on, to wait for a short time. Hang on a minute, I'm just coming. Hang out, it means to spend a lot of time in a place. We will spend the whole day hanging out by the pool. Hang about means to loiter, to roam. Come on, we haven't got time to hang about. Hang together means to stick together, to stay together. If you all hang together, you will succeed in your plan. Hang up. When we are having a conversation, we end the conversation, we are hanging up the phone. Hang over means to hover over somebody. The clouds of war will hang over the east. These are phrasal verbs. By adding something to the base verb, the meaning is changed slightly. Now, what is the complement of a verb? A word which completes the meaning of a sentence is called a complement. There are two types of complements. It can be a subject complement. If it is telling something about the subject, it is a subject complement. For example, Dinesh is a doctor. Now, a doctor here is the complement as it is telling us something about the subject. Object complement, it tells something about the object. Example, they made him the captain. The captain is the complement as it tells about the object him. They is the subject, him is the object, and we come to know something about the object. Who is him? The captain. So this is the complement. Now let us deal with the subject complement separately. Here is an example. The box is a present. The box is the subject. Is the linking verb. And a present, it is describing the or identifying with the subject. Hence, a present is a subject complement. Another example, the box smells funny. The box is the subject again. Smells is the linking verb. And funny is describing the box. Hence, it is a subject complement, describing the subject. Now, coming to object complement, similarly, a word that follows a direct object to rename it or state what it has become means to describe or tell its state of mind. For example, chocolate makes Tanya happy. Chocolate is the subject, makes is the linking verb, Tanya is the direct object of the sentence, and happy is completing the sentence and telling something about the direct object, Tanya. It is telling what the state of Tanya is. The state is happy. Hence, happy is an object complement. That brings us to the end of the lesson, children. Please go through the video once again, and if there is any confusion, we are going to discuss it in our online classes, and we are also going to discuss about the textual exercises in our next video lesson. That's thank you and take care.